Budget hearings to order.
And public defender.
And first on the agenda is the state's attorney. You have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Good morning, all. What I wanted to do is to start out with give you a little bit of a snapshot of where I think we are in terms of criminal justice, some of the good, some of the bad, and then some of the projections. I'd like to start off with some of the things that have happened that have been pretty good for us in the last couple of years. Our specialty courts are thriving and are expanding. I'm proud to say that we've got a veterans court. That's going to be a little bit different in the sense that those cases will not always result in dismissals. They're not true diversionary courts. But they are a specialty court that's designed to ensure, again, what is always the goal of the criminal justice system, that we not see people again. And to get these veterans into the right programs where they can hopefully, based on what the federal government provides, Veterans Administration provides, whatever we have available, to get them in a place where whatever underlying issues there are that might be vet-related can be dealt with. And obviously, it's not a free pass, and obviously, they still have to participate in the process. They've got to have some skin in the game, so to speak. But I'm very proud of the fact that we've got that up and running. We've only got a few people in it, but we are working toward it. And I think that's a program that was long overdue in the sense of making sure that we gave the people who fight for this country the opportunity to get all of the benefits that they're entitled to. Our drug court has expanded. Senate Bill 70 has got some ups and downs. I'm sure the sheriff talked a little bit about it yesterday. But one of the things that was good for us is that the Fourth and Seventh Circuits used to share a drug court. The Seventh Circuit now has its own drug court, and that's obviously predominantly Pennington County. And so we have expanded from probably having 20 people in that program to there are basically 40 spots, and we probably occupy 35 or more of them on any given moment. So I think that's a good thing. The drug courts have historically proven to be one of the best ways to get people who are deeply ensconced in the criminal justice system out. DUI court is now at capacity, so we've come up to the point where, again, we've got, I think it's 40 people in there, and we have, again, given a number of people an opportunity to get out of the system for good. And they have to do it by their own effort. We supply some supervision and some assistance. So all of those, I think, and funding for that largely came from Senate Bill 70. All of those are positive things that happened in the last year. One of the more negative things that I'm sure you heard about yesterday, both, I know you heard it from Eric because I was here, and from Sheriff Tome, is that meth use continues to skyrocket. The good news is that the numbers aren't quite as bad as they look. Senate Bill 17, this is the downside of it, created a presumption of probation. It means we're recycling defendants frequently. We've had some, because people are not going to go to the pen, very frequently they get out on bond. A judge is reluctant to hold somebody pending trial when they know when the case is over that they're not going to do time. So realistically, a lot of these folks are getting out on bond. We're putting them on 24/7, which has always been a successful program for us, and they're violating. Just last week, we had a guy who had six 24/7 violations, all for methamphetamine, and over our objections, the judge gave him a PR bond after the sixth one. So we're recycling them. So sometimes people are on a meth charge, they get out on bond, they get another meth charge, they get out on bond, they get another meth charge, they get out on bond, and so we end up with four, five, or six cases that we close simultaneously. So in some senses, the numbers are a little bit exaggerated, because even for Eric's people who have to deal with individual defendants, they are putting away four or five or six files at a time. Uh-huh. Commissioner Troutman, you had your hand up.
I was just going to ask, is there any kind of movement in peer or even just to inform them? I know that when I've been down there the last 2 years and I've talked about some things that are, you know, happening with mental illness and so on, and they think they have fixed everything. How is that being approached?
Well, there are two things that are happening this summer. One is a legislative summer study on methamphetamine. I know the State's Attorneys Association is going to participate in that. The other is a governor's task force on methamphetamine, or drug cases generally. I think they're also addressing heroin. I've been asked to participate in that, and I'll be going out for a series of monthly meetings with a few other law enforcement, the governor's office, defense attorneys. It's a group of about 10 statewide. So I'll be participating in that. You probably saw the paper reported an outside consulting agency was talking about some of the things we should do to double down on Senate Bill 70, including making methamphetamine and other controlled substances either legal or a misdemeanor, and effectively decriminalizing methamphetamine. And I think that would be a catastrophe. It would certainly make, you know, Eric's job easier and my job easier, but I think the citizens of Pennington County would be the ones that paid. Methamphetamine is a leading indicator of violent behavior. That's not just related to the fact that it's illegal, although obviously some of that plays in. If you can't call the cops when somebody rips you off, you carry a gun. You fight for your own product. But some of it is the effect of methamphetamine. Unlike heroin, for instance, which people are dangerous on heroin mostly when they're coming down and mostly when they're looking for it and they don't have money. So they break into people's houses, they rob people. What happens with methamphetamine is even when you're on it, you become paranoid, you become violent, you become hypervigilant, and that violence is not just while you're looking for it, not just when you're coming down, but even when you're on it. So it basically creates a very violent environment. So the bad news is that our numbers are not likely to get better in terms of methamphetamine. I don't think that what we're doing is working. I see some things on the horizon that might be helpful, and I'll touch base on those a little bit later. But these folks aren't going to the pen, which means we're recycling them in the local system. And that's putting a great strain on our law enforcement, our street deputies, a great strain on our jail, and a great strain on our court services, not to mention my office and Eric's office. The worst news is that, as we just discussed, methamphetamine leads to violence inherently and because of the illegal nature. And if you have any doubt of it, take a look at kind of what's been happening in Rapid over the last couple of years. I know that Mr. Witcher talked yesterday about the fact that most of his cases are nonviolent and misdemeanors. He's including methamphetamine in that calculus, and I don't think I agree with that. Methamphetamine, as I said, I believe is a leading indicator. Pennington County's previous record for homicides in a year was 5. In 2015, we had 10. Mm-hmm. We thought we had 9, and then we discovered Jessica Rayfield. So the violence is not just in the community of methamphetamine. I think violence breeds violence. If people out on the street, whether it's gangs or just, you know, people on the outside of the law, when one group of that becomes more violent, the methamphetamine users, the methamphetamine dealers, everybody else is going to get more violent to deal with it. You get used to hearing about it, you get used to seeing it, and you become inured to it. And so ultimately, I think that we've become, in large part because of the methamphetamine epidemic, a more violent community. And there need to be some places to put that. There need to be some ways to deal with that. And again, I'll touch base on those in just a sec. One other thing that I did want to give you an update on that perhaps is not directly related to my budget, but is very much related, I think, to what the county might be looking at in the future, is the status of the ICWA lawsuit. You're aware that Judge Viken has indicated he intends to enter an order. He's invited some commentary from the sides. But something that happened after he made the pronouncement is that the Bureau of Indian Affairs came down with a series of regulations designed to implement ICWA. It was the first update that they'd had on those regulations in quite a while. The good news for Pennington County is that their recommendations are very much in line with exactly what we do and what we have done to respond to what we felt were the legitimate concerns related to the ICWA lawsuit, not the overreaching request that basically we have a full-blown jury trial the first day that we have this, you know, this situation or this case come live. They specifically rejected, and in commentary explained why they specifically rejected, most of the positions that are still under issue in the ICWA lawsuit. So I'm hopeful that that will mean, as we move forward, that we don't have to do a great deal in terms of staffing or changing to our practices and procedures. Hopefully there won't be a huge increase to the county, either in terms of my staff or in terms of court-appointed attorneys in that. So I just wanted to make you aware of that. The other things that I'd like to touch base on that relate to future possibilities, Detox has started a meth opiate program. It's only, I think, 13 beds, and it is an 8 or 9 month program, which means you're getting 15, 20 people through a year. But it's a start. Like I said, these people tend to come through over and over and over again. They drive up numbers at detox, at the jail, at the public defender's office, at the state's attorney's office, in the court system. And I think it's a good start. Now, whether we can expand that when we get over to the new building or not, that's something the sheriff's going to have to talk to you about in the future. But I do appreciate the fact that, again, Senate Bill 70 did provide some local funding for things like that. And that's one of the good things that I see coming out of Senate Bill 70. The second thing that's coming up is our young adult diversion. You're aware that we've been running a trial program, basically 8 to 10 kids at a time. And by kids, I now mean 18 to 25-year-olds. We are presently in the process of hiring for somebody to run that program, and we're hoping that we'll be able to increase that tenfold, to have 80 to 100 kids coming through the system. And again, the goal is to get the kids that are just making their first contacts. Unlike the other diversion courts, this is aimed at the kids that are starting their criminal careers. Maybe they've got a juvenile past, but they're young and they're still hopefully reachable. And our goal is always to make sure that it is harder to go through the young adult diversion than it would be just to plead guilty. If you can just pay a fine and walk out, we want it to be a little harder than that, a little more personal involvement, because that's what gives us the hope that you won't be back. We are working with some community partners on that. Since we didn't get the full MacArthur grant, we don't have as much in terms of potential seed money for community programs. In other words, when we get a kid, we might want to send them through a particular program. So LifeWays comes to mind, or the MAD Alive at 25 is a good example. The more programs you have for the more wider range of kids, the better. Without the seed money from MacArthur, we're largely looking at going, hey, can you take this kid, and we have no money to give you. So we are working with some community partners. I've been talking to the folks over at Collective Impact, East of Fifth, the Community Conversations folks. There are some things that we're looking at in terms of places to put these kids. And again, to demonstrate a commitment to getting on the right track in exchange for an absolutely clean criminal record. And we think that's a good trade both for us and for them. The risk assessment instrument, I talked to you a little bit about as I bogarted some of Eric's time yesterday. And I think that that will also have an impact on the jail and allow the sheriff to do some of the things he was talking about that are revenue positive to the county. And we are obviously still looking at some sentencing alternatives, but again, you know, Mr. Witcher talked yesterday about having people clean up trash. That's a limited amount of people that you can send out to do that. What you're really looking for in terms of community service are programs that can sign off and say this person has done good work for the community, but that requires supervision, protocols, probably insurance. So nobody's just going to take, we can't just throw 100 people into community service and say we'll give away a fine, you know, we won't fine you, we'll just put you in community service. We have to have a place to put them in community service. And I do think that the sheriff's office is looking at expanding some of their in-house programs, and I'm hoping that the young adult diversion program and that community outreach that we do there will also kind of fold back on itself and give us an opportunity to cultivate some of those programs, not just for our young adult diversion people, but for our community in general.
And that Health and Human Services is working with the sheriff and you guys as well, where detox costs $300 a day, but crisis care is $23 a day. I mean, that's a huge savings by doing some of those programs like the Ray and other things that we are doing to actually save a lot of money. And that's per person. So Barry can tell us a little bit more about that, but it needs more space, of course, in one sense, but the other, it saves a lot of money by changing and doing programs that actually will not have recidivism as much, which is a positive for our community all the way through, and that's what I was kind of trying to say the other day. It's a big positive of what you guys are all working together, and it's becoming a team of people through the system instead of individual. And that's what I see as being as they're doing in the community now, collective impact, to see how we can bring all these sources together into one, which it does. It saves millions of dollars that way. So thank you for all you do, Mr. Vargo.
Well, thank you. I'm glad people notice. I will tell you, one of the things that made me kind of happy, we put out the applications for the data analyst, Ray Person, and for the young adult diversion coordinator. And a couple of the people who applied specified that they applied because they knew what we'd done in the juvenile program and that we had a reputation for actually working and not just creating an office. And then you go sit in a corner and we, you know, issue press releases about the office. We get out and we get things done as a group.
And again, and so, you can see those differences from people and the recidivism from the Ray program on the juvenile justice system. So it's proven. It's not a guess because they've been doing it about, what, 3 years?
Almost four.
Yeah, so.
The other thing that's coming up that the commission needs to be aware of is Marcy's Law. And that won't come up until January, but as a constitutional amendment, I know that the bar is voting, I think today, as to whether to oppose it or not. I believe the State's Attorneys Association, the vote is ongoing, and I think they will also vote to oppose it, but I also believe that it will pass. For simplistic reason, there'll probably be $1 million of advertising in favor and not a dime against. Neither the counties nor the state, the two entities that'll be required to spend all of the money if it passes, will be allowed to oppose it in terms of spending any kind of money on it. And I know that the out-of-state interests have put over $1 million into North Dakota already because they've received the opposition in North Dakota is stronger than the opposition they've had thus far in South Dakota. So the bottom line is there'll be a lot of advertising and it'll be very simplistic. Are you in favor of victims' rights? And people are gonna say yes, and they're gonna vote yes, and then it'll be in the Constitution. It will mean a sea change in terms of how we have to do victim notification and the number of cases on which we have to do victim notification. Instead of just felonies and violent misdemeanors, it will now expand to all cases where someone can claim to be a victim. And a victim is defined not only as the person who endures the injury, but that person's immediate family, and even literally friends or other people similarly situated, I think is the exact language. So we're talking about expanding probably fourfold, if not more, the number of cases on which we have to do formal victim notifications. I will tell you, we received good news just this week. We did apply for a VOCA, second VOCA grant to us, you know, to our victims assistance program. We have not received formal word back, so it's not in this budget. But if we get the formal word consistent with what they told us this week, we would have two funded positions next year through the VOCA grant. And we would ask probably then for a supplement and then alter the budget for next year. But that would be obviously revenue neutral to the county. And it would at least be a start on what would be required if Marcy's Law passes, because I do anticipate that it will pass, and I do anticipate that it will be a significant change to how things have to be done in the county. So going straight to the numbers, if you look at our base budget, because we submitted it as requested in terms of the base budget for this year, and then additional FTE requests, in the base budget, the salaries went up essentially by the amount of group insurance went up. And so that's something that's largely beyond our control. Our professional fees, we altered based on our 2015 actual and IT's request that we adjust our computer rotations. So again, some of that. Publishing is one that we are doing something a little bit different. It's only about half of the increase in publishing. $2,700, we've got a $5,300 request for increase in publishing. 27 of that is related to the Native Sun News. And we've decided that it makes sense, even though we're not, unlike the treasurer's office and the auditor's office, we don't have to publish in all papers of record, just a paper of record. But it seems appropriate to me in cases where we know that we're dealing with Native Americans, and specifically that means our ICWA cases, that we should publish in both the Journal and the Native Sun News, because that's going to reach more people who might be the target of the parents we haven't found or haven't reached yet. Because of the fact that it travels further nationwide, some people who are native are going to be reading that even if they've moved out of the community. I think it's also appropriate to have it in the journal. So we didn't propose trying to figure out which one, because frequently we have both native and non-native people involved in an ICWA case. But in an ICWA case where we know we have native parents, we felt it appropriate to add that. Then the additional increase is simply related to the journal in terms of our actual filings and their increases in ad costs. As far as the second budget, the FTEs, these are the same two positions that I was requesting last year, the felony attorney and a secretary for the felony attorney. I think the last 6-8 weeks are kind of illustrative of why we need that. Unlike the public defender's office, we can't go to the courts and say we're too busy to prosecute your cases. Mm-hmm. And in the last 6 to 8 weeks, we have had 4 murder cases come live, in other words, become a major part of our caseload, involving 8 total defendants. 5 of those are capital eligible, meaning that as I read the cases and as I read the facts, the aggravating circumstances that are required to seek the death penalty may exist in those cases. And they are obviously first-degree murder cases. Now, whether we will seek the death penalty on those, I do not know yet. The process that I have pledged to undergo allows the defense to have input and allows the families to have input, and I have not gone through that process yet. We're still pretty early on them. But if you compare what we're doing and the adjustments that we have to make, the parallel to the public defender's office and the request that Eric was making yesterday, they do half of the felonies in this county. We do them all. They do 18% of the first class 1 misdemeanors. They do 10% of the class 2 misdemeanors. And if we look at these 5 capital eligible cases, it's kind of a bell curve. The public defender's office handles very few of the least serious misdemeanors, but actually potentially fewer of the most serious felonies. Part of that's just the way things work. As you get into the most serious cases, you have the most witnesses, you have the most potential for conflicts, where they've represented a witness or now represent a witness, and so they get out. But as a way of illustration, on those 5 capital eligible cases, the public defender's office is responsible for 1 defendant. Obviously, we once again have all 5, and we bear the burden of proof. The ability to respond to that, I think, speaks very well of the people we have. But just as a for instance, we're losing a felony attorney now. We're going to promote somebody from the misdemeanor division. Somebody's going to Black Hills Corp, and you know, you can't blame them. Commissioner Busgrood has mentioned many times that we tend to be a training ground sometimes. But the person that comes up is unlikely to be able to handle the same caseload at the same efficacy. And so what we end up doing is putting a great deal of a burden. I think that my people have responded incredibly well this last 6 months. We've been short some people. We've got 3 coming on in the next 2 months. And I think that they have done yeoman's work. My misdemeanor division especially has been absolutely amazing. 2 people are covering, or really 3 are covering the work of 5. And one of my felony attorneys has basically gone down and he's doing a felony caseload and a misdemeanor caseload. That's great. But you can't expect it to go forever. People who do that for long periods of time burn out and leave, whether or not they get a job offer with a whole lot more money. And so I am again requesting an additional felony attorney. It certainly follows the numbers. I didn't this year decide to inundate you with a lot of numbers about where the felony cases have gone, because I know that you heard it from Mr. Witcher and from Sheriff Tom. So ultimately, I think we are being very restrained. I suppose there is some possibility that if there are significant requests from the public defender expert witnesses in their capital case or in any of the other 4 cases from the private counsel that are handling it, it's possible that we might have to come back and ask for a supplement. Because largely what we do is responsive in terms of how deeply we get into expert witnesses in particular.
Mr. Vargo,
The public defender said 50 to 100,000. Is that taking care of your side and his, or you're asking for basically the same amount if that happens?
I don't know how his is broken down. Perhaps if I sat down with him or if I hear him tell you guys with greater detail, if part of that is a mitigation expert, we're not going to hire an aggravation expert. That's something we just absorb in-house. One of the great things about our prosecutor training that I've talked to you guys many times and in the budget process a few times about, we had prosecutor training last week, Friday afternoon. And it goes from 2 to 4, and it was on direct and cross-examination. It was aimed at the youngest attorneys. And then after that, I spent about 2 hours talking to the state's attorney in Meade County and the state's attorney in Lawrence County about capital cases, because John Fitzgerald's done 3 of them. Kevin Kroll has 1 that's potentially capital on his desk. And so we've had a better opportunity. We'll largely absorb that kind of a function. On the other hand, if they hire outside psychiatrists, specialists of some kind to say that there's a diminished capacity defense, we might need to respond in kind. So I don't know where it would be. It would be no more than what he's requesting, presumably somewhat less.
So you'd be combining between the 50 and 100,000, both of you?
No, I think he's saying that he might ask for 50 to 100,000. I would say that if he asks for that, I would ask for no more than where he's going.
Okay.
We would presumably be able to hire an expert for a similar amount. I will warn you, though, that there are 4 other cases where if the attorneys make requests for experts from the court, the cost comes back to the county. It's a separate line item, but it comes back to the county, and we might be required to deal with it.
So that'd be this year or next year's budget?
Almost certainly in the 2017 budget for us, because by the time, let's say Eric asks you for a supplement, hires, let's say, a psychiatrist to establish a diminished capacity defense, by the time we get that report and decide whether we need an expert to respond to it, we'd almost certainly be into next year.
So what is your total amount this year that you're asking for, plus those two with those two FTEs in there? I guess
total amount for the 2017 budget?
Yes.
It's an additional $203,000.
So it's the $4,372,764 plus the $148,745. That's at the bottom of the summary budget.
Well, I don't know. The way I figured it was about $203,700 additional, but because that takes into account, you added some in your revenues to it.
So you're saying the 89,691 plus the 203?
No.
Okay.
Where's the 89?
Where's the 89, Commissioner?
Net change plus
no,
the FTEs?
It's the 89 plus the 41 plus the...
Because the two FTEs and the 89,691, is that what we're saying? You see what I'm saying, Busker? His change is $89,691.
Yeah. What else you would add to that?
And then his two FTEs add up to 203?
Request.
No.
Oh, I think what you're... Okay, I think I see where you are.
Okay.
If you look at our total budget under the... Is this the spreadsheet they've...
2017? 0151?
I want to make sure we're on the same piece of paper, because otherwise we speak at cross purposes.
This is where I'm seeing it, right here.
Here it is.
This is the change from your department, right?
Correct.
Is there any other money added in there besides the FTEs?
No.
Okay, so, and the FTEs would cost?
Next page.
148.
There's one.
Okay.
Yep.
Basically 150.
148,745.
That's the two FTEs with the roll-ups.
691. What was the other number? Sorry.
148,745.
48,745.
And I also added the 41,943, which is the MacArthur grant, but then you can subtract the 50 grand. Increase in revenue, so
that's a wash. But
yeah, basically that's a wash.
So with that, you got 203.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank
that's
you.
All right. Which, you know, if you're really interested, is 5.3%.
Thank you.
Okay, these, your budget here is, includes mentals, victims assistance, every other little department that you've got over there.
Except the, to the extent that there's now the MacArthur budget that's separate.
Yeah, that's separate, but.
But correct.
Otherwise, it includes all those that used to all have their own budget. Thank you for doing that very much. I assume it's her idea, not yours.
I think actually it might have been Susan's idea, the auditor's idea, and then I just said, yes.
Nice.
Thank you. It makes it much easier for us.
And we have everything combined and we haven't missed anything.
Knock on wood, we have not missed anything.
Yeah, don't do that to us again.
You know I have to give you a little bit of crap about that.
I figured that was coming.
I didn't do too bad on you.
Do you have any other questions for Mark? Any other questions?
Yeah, well, I have one more. You want one more attorney, one more secretary. Is this going to end or is it not up to you, just up to how many arrests we make every year? And
there are a lot of different factors. The number of arrests is clearly part of it. If we don't do something at the front end about methamphetamine, the criminal justice system responds to community circumstances. It doesn't create them. It can help ameliorate them, but it doesn't, we don't get to lead it. So part of it is going to be the number of arrests. Part of it's going to be the number of cases that get, or the number of attorneys you give to the public defender's office, which inherently changes the nature of practice over in that building. The more attorneys you have, the more motions you see, the more trials you see.
Back further than that, the more cops you have, the more arrests you have, the more attorneys you have, the more defenders you have, the more prosecutors you have, the more jailers you have, the more, I mean, it's a never-ending nightmare. And not your fault, I understand. Right. But with one more of each, you're going to be okay in the near future.
I believe we're okay in the near future, and I believe that we could adjust to the loss of, I'll tell you honestly, we've got three judge positions coming open in this county in the next probably 5 years. I have people that are interested in it and that would be very good at it. And if I lost one of them, that's going to be one of your best people. I think that this would give us some room to say, okay, we'll have two people who can't handle quite the same caseload at quite the same level of expertise.
Okay.
But yes, that's where I see it.
Thanks, Mark.
Yes. Does anyone have any direction relative to this budget that we need to look at before we move on?
Thanks, Mark.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mark.
Thank you.
Is this yours?
No.
Okay.
We should probably be thanking your chief financial officer there.
Okay, we're a little ahead of schedule, but I think we're ready for
dispatch.
Yes. CC, good morning.
USCC dispatch.
Good morning.
Thank you.
Good morning.
Morning, thank you.
Thanks, Ted.
You're welcome.
I haven't met you. I'm Nancy.
Hi, I'm Kevin Carley. For those of you that haven't met me yet or don't recall, I've been the director over at the center for about 3.5 months now. Retired from the Highway Patrol after about 26 years of service there. And just to kind of give you an update of some of the things that we've been working on or how things have been going over at the center during my time there. As you know, we experienced a high turnover during the second half of 2015. I'm happy to report that we are now fully staffed and we're about 75% trained, so we're moving in the right direction there. We're very happy about that. As you know, we assumed the Department of Public Safety mission May 1st of 2015. There was initially a learning curve that was slowed by the turnover, the significant turnover that we experienced the second half of 2015, but I think we're on track there, and based on the feedback that I'm getting from the state users, they're satisfied with the level of service we are providing now, so I'm happy to report that. In 2015, we answered 644,000 911 calls compared to 599,000 in 2014, so we're experiencing growth. There were 350, a little over 350,000 CAT events, which a CAT event is any time a dispatcher gets a call where they have to take action and actually dispatch or do something with the call. We consider that a CAT event. So in 2015, there were a little over 349,000 CAT events compared to 250,000 in 2014. And we expect that number to reach 400,000 so far how things are going in 2016. I've been working to improve our level of communication with the users as well as the surrounding PSAPs. Now, our law enforcement partners, the sheriff's offices and the police departments, they all communicate. They work well together. And we have that same obligation as a 911 center here to reach out and work with our surrounding 911 centers. That's something that I felt was lacking when I took over. So I've actually been out visiting those PSAPs and been on site and working to improve that information so we can exchange, or that communication so we can exchange information. And it's going to allow us to provide a better service to our users and a better service to citizens as well. I conducted an internal employee survey through SurveyMonkey, got feedback from the employees, and it was good feedback. Found out that the overwhelming majority of our employees at the center are satisfied with their job here with the county and in the center. And we identified some issues that we need to work on, which we're going to be striving to work on through 2016. We're also preparing the same type of survey for our users so we can get feedback from the police department, the sheriff's office, all of our major users, so we can identify any issues we have there as well and work on those. Progressing into the budget, for 2017, our budget is, we're proposing a overall 3% increase. That's mostly just due to promotions or reclassifications or promotions that we anticipate in 2017. The budget we have was prepared with no merit or COLA, as we were directed. One thing that we did do for 2017 in an effort to try to improve our revenues is typically in the past, it's been the city and the county who have every year provided a 3% increase in our revenues, but we didn't think that was fair because we have other users that we have contract services with, and we've never gone back to those users really and asked them for that 3% increase, and we did that this year. So we've asked the Department of Public Safety, Box Elder Police Department, Jackson County, Piedmont Fire and Ambulance, and the National Park Service to also provide us with a 3% increase in fees as well, so that it's not just the county and the city that are providing more fees. And we haven't done that for a long time, so we think it's a perfectly reasonable thing for us to do that. Also for 2017, my wages have been moved into the operations services and contracts line item away from personal services because, as you know, I'm actually an employee of the state and my wages are reimbursed to the state by the county, so that does no longer comes out of personal services, it comes out of contract services. Our operations budget is held as the same level at 2016 with no increase. One of the things that I identified very quickly was that I believe we are suffering from a staffing shortage. We have not had an increase in FTE in the center for at least 5 years. I think it's closer to 7 years and maybe longer. That's data that I'm not able to find currently in the record, so I'm working through it. But I know for certain we haven't experienced a growth in FTEs in at least 5 years. All of our users, the fire department, the sheriff's office, the police department, the public Department of Public Safety, they have all adding staffing, which increases our workload, but we haven't added any staffing. And as you can see by the numbers, our CAT events, our 911 calls are all growing, but we haven't experienced any FTE growth, with the exception of the five FTEs that we obtained when we adopted the state mission. Yeah. Those came along with that state mission. So what that means is that we're using overtime shifts to cover minimums. We have minimums that we have to meet so that we can provide a good level of service to all of our users and have enough staffing there to answer the 911 calls.
Do you have a total, sir, of the overtime used?
Yes, well, I have an average. For the first 5 months of 2015, a year ago, we were averaging about $5,600 a month in overtime. For the first 5 months of 2016, we're averaging $13,497. So it's over double of what we're a month is what we're averaging a month. So it's more than double of what we're paying in overtime. And I'm very thankful that the staff in the center, they're all very willing to step up. They're dedicated employees. They're willing to step up and cover those overtime shifts. But the other side of that is we have to be concerned about their health and well-being, because it is a stressful position. And when they have to come in on a day off or stay 2 or 4 extra hours, and in the long run, it wears on those employees. And I think that's one of the things that contributed to the high turnover we had at the end of 2015, is people were just getting to the point where they're getting burned out. So I think we're at that point, and so we're proposing an increase of 2 FTEs in this budget. Now, even though we're proposing those 2 FTEs, we really don't have to ask for a significant increase in the budget for 2 reasons. The first one is because when we took those 5 FTEs from the state to cover the state mission, we were able to determine that really 5 is not enough. And it's really, the state had 9 FTEs to do the same thing that we're trying to accomplish with 5. Because it's a consolidation of services, we can actually provide the same level of service with fewer FTEs. But 5 is not enough. And we actually, 5 FTEs means we could have 1 person at the state radio council 24 hours a day. 1 person's not enough. During peak times, about 19 hours out of the day, we actually need 2. So we've been covering that second person with overtime. So that's one of the reasons why that overtime figure is as high as it is. So we actually went back to the Department of Public Safety and told them that we think they should fund another FTE, an additional FTE, to get us to 6 that would help us get that overtime number down, get that under control. We haven't heard back from the Department of Public Safety yet. They initially received that very well. And of course, the state has their process that they have to go through. So we're waiting to hear back from them. So that FTE would be funded by the Department of Public Safety. So there would be no increase in our personal service budget because of that FTE. So that FTE is dependent on them saying yes. If they were to deny, turn that request down, then we wouldn't pursue that FTE. The second FTE position we believe we can fund out of our existing personal services, because with my wages moved over to operational services instead of personnel services, that money is still in personal services. And so we can use that money to fund another FTE position. So again, we believe we can do that without an increase in our personal services budget. And we think that money is already there, it exists, and we can just use it for that additional FTE is what we'd like to do, if possible.
Well, sir, you're asking for 2 additional, or those are the 2?
We're asking for 2 additional.
Besides the 2 that you've covered?
No, those are the 2. So we're currently at 46.5. We'd like to increase it to 48.5. One being funded by the state, the other being funded by the fact that my wages were moved out of personal services into contract services. So again, we've gone back to the Department of Public Safety and asked them for a 3% increase, which they have initially agreed to. And we've also asked them to fund that additional FTE, which would be a cost of about $58,000 to public safety just for that FTE. Total cost, I think, would be around $67,000. We also increased our overtime budget. As I said, we're finding that we just didn't have enough money allocated for overtime. So we've had a shortfall. We had a major shortfall last year. We were initially started this year out very short, but we're starting to catch up because we're trying to do some different things with our scheduling as well to maximize our manpower to see if we can't squeeze the best out of our resources. But we did increase that overtime budget for 2017 by 1%. We provided you with a chart in your packet there that demonstrates the growth that we've experienced in the last 5 years through the 911 calls and the CAT events. And we provided the overview of the budget. With that, do you have any questions?
I do. Ted, maybe you can answer. I don't know. Maybe you can. It looks like in your personnel, group insurance went up $51,000, which is more than the salaries and wages. Is that how Is that figure right?
I'll have, Ted is the nuts and bolts guy on the budget, so I'll have him answer that.
It is right, yeah, that's the insurance we, with the one additional, but even the one additional that the state would pay for, we put that in what the state would pay, so their $58,000 would cover that. So that's just normal insurance increases, the ones that we were directed, you know, the adjustments that we were told to make.
A lot of money.
Health and dental rate adjustments is what it was.
Wow, that's a lot.
Okay, any other questions?
I'd like to say something. I'm glad we picked you.
Thank you.
Or, however you say, affirmatively picked you after the fact, that you went through a group of people that knew what they were doing, because just listening to the things and the changes, you care about the public, you care about your job, and you can see it in everything that you just said to us. So, very efficient at what you do, and they picked a good fit, and we appreciate that, sir.
Thank
you. And Ted, you always do a good job, and we appreciate you too, but, and I don't mean that in a, I never say things quite how you're supposed to say them, but just to say, awesome. I like listen to all the things that make you a good manager, and you just proved it, so.
Thank you for saying that.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, any other questions? I think you're doing a good job.
Thank you.
And,
thanks, Kevin.
What a challenge.
Yes, yeah, that's the fun part, right?
So with what's the total amount of increase in your department then this year?
3%.
3%, which is, tell me the dollar amount.
$109,455, I'm sorry.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah, we just want to clarify, we're asking for one additional FTE net, because we've, with the money we already have in personal services, we can fund that FTE, and then.
So the 109,455 has the FTE?
Well, it is, but there's no increase in the budget, because the one FTE, what we're proposing to do is put in the director's slot in the wage budget a dispatcher FTE. So that would not increase the budget, because we had to move his wages to operations because of the arrangement with the state.
Okay.
So his wages become like a utility bill, if you will. Okay. We're paying him out of the operations budget.
Okay.
That's a good idea.
That's an analogy I've used.
You're a utility now, Kevin.
Aren't you glad to know you're a utility?
But we can put a dispatcher FTE in there, and it doesn't increase the budget.
Okay.
And then the actual FTE increase that would take us to 47.5 FTEs, we're proposing the state pay for that 100%. So there's no increase to the budget on either one of them.
It's just the authorized number.
We're just looking
FTEs.
To authorize our FTE right. by one. And again, if the state was to say no, then we would still be at what we are this year, which is 46.5.
Okay.
And at that point, with all the overtime, that'd be crazy if we didn't.
I know.
Do something.
I mean,
different
the overtime
for you,
essentially so. Pays for that person.
Right.
So.
That's the bottom line. It.
Right.
Right.
When you're paying in 2015 $5,600 a month, or in 2016 $13,409. That's you
that's
need
a lot
to do
of money.
Something different.
Right.
And like I said, I'm concerned about the health and well-being of the employees.
It
takes its toll.
It really does. If you're overtiming that much, it's
yeah.
You burn out a lot quicker.
The benefits of having additional pay only go so far, and then it's like, okay, now I just need
a break.
Some rest, yeah.
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 Thanks,
well, and also for the public, because when they get tired and run down and maybe not quite so enthusiastic about their job, then when they're answering those emergency calls, right. It isn't quite up to par. It can't be.
Yes.
So we need to take that responsibility that we provide a good service.
And that's huge.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, yes. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Have a good day.
You too.
Okay, again, we're moving right along, and our next budget will be emergency management.
Justin was on another call. He'll be right down.
Sure.
Okay.
On a 5-minute break.
Are you ready, Dustin?
Absolutely.
Then we're at your mercy.
Or the other way around, as the case may be.
That could be.
Morning, members of the commission. Dustin Willett, Pennington County Emergency Manager. Stand before you, happy to go over the 2017 budget, answer any questions or concerns you may have. Do you just want me to flip through this prepared budget one by one and just give a brief?
Correct.
Okay, all right. So does the packet you have with my budget start with emergency responses? Is that the first budget you see? 101-0285?
We've got 226-0285 on ours.
Okay, that's a, like I said, I've got several different budgets that my office coordinates, so let me flip to that one. So 226-0285 is the main emergency management budget. Revenues for this are a federal pass-through grant, the Emergency Management Performance Grant, that comes from Congress, is administered to the state as the primary grantee, and then distributed to counties that participate in what State Office of Emergency Management calls the state and local agreement. Those are the documents that you see before you at least quarterly on the commission, where we report and do that grant monitoring and all that reporting for that state and local agreement for that emergency management performance grant. So that grant is a significant source of revenue for our department. And then the costs remaining to our department outside of what that grant covers are split equally between the City of Rapid City and Pennington County. So there's an operating transfer from Pennington County, from the general fund, that supports basically 25% of my budget, and then that's a rough number, but close, and then an equal amount, another 25% operating transfer basically from the City of Rapid City's general fund to support my office. Everything that we do in my office right now is broken down into initiatives that are supported or mandated either through state law or the state and local agreement that we sign and agree to make certain performance measures, training, education, data collection, and preparedness planning, again, through that state and local agreement to be eligible for those grant dollars, and then also through an emergency management performance standard, which is a third-party developed standard that's actually an international standard on what emergency management organizations should be doing. So my office is broken down, this budget is broken down basically under exercise and training, outreach and education, hazard identification and planning, public warning and information, emergency operations center, and then we have the incident management team and just the basic emergency management administration, the office costs. And then everything that we do budget-wise is programmed into those budget areas. So.
Just to remind everyone, this budget is annually audited by the state auditing?
Yes, and more rigorously recently than maybe even in years past. The state, obviously, doesn't take, unless
concerned.
You've been living under a rock, the state is certainly being scrutinized about grant administration from a federal level on a number of different fronts. So they are very, very meticulous in their grant review and their grant auditing. So,
okay.
Yes. Any questions on the 226-0285 budget?
Apparently not. Just a comment. I think, given the situation you have to deal with, your office has more bookkeeping and money tracking responsibility than just about anything beyond the treasurer and the auditor.
Yeah, we've got a lot of grants that we manage, a lot of federal programs that we have to account for and audit. Just as a FYI, gee whiz kind of a thing, I thought I had signed the final stuff quite a while ago, and come to find out that I actually signed we finally wrapped up the closeout documents for the October 2013 Blizzard Winter Storm Atlas just a couple weeks ago.
Wow.
So my paperwork on a 2013 event ended just a couple weeks ago. So yeah, those can drag out and are pretty involved.
Okay. So is, this may be a question you can or can't answer, but what percentage of the activity that your department does would be mandated by state or federal?
The difficult part in answering that question is, I'll take one example out of the entire spectrum of what we do. But within that state and local agreement, we are mandated to do public awareness for winter storms. That's one thing that we have to do. So while we are mandated to do some type of public awareness campaign for winter storms to our, to the citizens that we serve, the population that we serve, what's not detailed is exactly what that program is or how we deliver that program, or, you know, do we spend, you know, $150,000 on a professionally produced cinematic, you know, 5-minute commercial infomercial, or do we print a couple flyers and hand them out and do a checkbox and call it good? So the responsibility on me is to try to be as fiscally conservative and responsible as possible to accomplish what I believe and what I interpret is the intent of what they want done, and not do that extravagantly, but do that efficiently and effectively. So almost everything, I can't think of anything we do that doesn't tie back to something we are asked to do, either through state statute, FEMA, or the state and local agreement through state OEM. So I don't think there's anything my office does on our own that we're not asked to do. It's just a matter of the extent and the scope of what those programs or projects are. Does that make sense?
Yep, it does. So really, we can't eliminate your department.
Again, because... tough question to answer.
I'm giving you a bad time, but we have a new commissioner coming in, and I'm just trying to help understand that.
So state law mandates that counties have a county emergency management program and a county emergency manager.
Mm-hmm.
And that's it.
Mm-hmm.
How you define what that program is and who you define who that manager is
up to
is
us.
Up to you.
Yeah.
Pennington County, as the second most populous county in South Dakota, and with the critical infrastructure, the assets, and the threats that we face, the other, obviously the most populous county is Minnehaha, and they have some of the same similar threats, but if you even just look at the topography, we go from flatland agriculture, Cheyenne River, to Badlands, into the second largest city in South Dakota, and then up into National Forest and the Black Hills and the tourist industry, Mount Rushmore. The population, the Pennington County is incredibly diverse, and that's a strength and an asset and a draw and an amazing thing about Pennington County. But when you're doing threat hazard identification and risk assessments on something that diverse, it poses a lot of challenges to planning and infrastructure protection and emergency management. So I think our office is sized absolutely appropriately for the mission that we have. I would not be able to meet our mission if I had less, and I think we are very respectively meeting our mission with what we have. So.
In addition to the things you named as challenges, interfacing with U.S. Forest Service personnel, National Park Service personnel, things of that kind, and their regulations,
mm-hmm.
Adds a little flavor to what efforts you might mobilize.
Flavor is a awesome word, mm-hmm. Chairman Peterson. It can get awfully interesting, and the platform, and I've said this every time I've come before you and explained our program, and I'm happy to do that. I promoted myself, marketed myself for this position based on the platform of establishing relationships. And if you just try to charge headlong into this job based on nothing but, well, the regulation says this and the rules say this and this book says this, you're not going to get very far. It's having those personal relationships, having the park superintendents and the lead law enforcement officers on speed dial and knowing them on a first-name basis and saying, okay, here's our situation, here's where we are, here's where we need to get, how do we make that happen? And it's having those personal and professional relationships, cultivating those relationships and maintaining those relationships that allow our office to accomplish its mission. It's not trying to wade through the rule books and the procedure books because everybody has their own and they're all at least this thick and multiple volumes.
So. I just another comment. I think that the change, I mean, technically, Rapid City could have their own emergency management department, and they have had pseudo type of thing in the past. But it's become much more effective since Rapid City and the county have collaboratively come together. It creates a continuity of how to handle things. And also, I think it's much more efficient financially. But we talk a lot because this is our job. To be financially responsible. But it is also, and to me more importantly, our job to make sure people are safe or that if something happens, we're there to help. And if we do it with others, we're much more effective. And I thank you for keeping those efforts going and improving relationships.
You bet. Yeah, public safety is a primary function of government, a fundamental pillar of what government is. That does not equate to a blank check. Mm-hmm. And the great thing about the way the office is set up now and the way the funding is set up now is in essence, what it means is for every dollar that comes out of the Pennington County general fund, it is matched by three other dollars from other funding sources. So for every $1 that I ask for through that operating fund transfer, we actually get $3 in addition to that back into that budget. So it makes a lot of sense to partner the way we've partnered with the groups that we've partnered with to make that happen.
You do a great job.
Thank you, Linda.
Thanks, Dustin.
All right, next budget you have?
What's that?
What budget do you have next? I've got a whole stack of budgets that I...
Yeah, we've got the... the 101-0911, your EM operating.
That's the operating transfer that supports the budget we just talked about?
Yeah.
And that's the one that's matched equally with the city. So that's the same amount of money that the city puts in?
Yep. And, you know...
The other budgets, really quickly, I won't beleaguer the fact. I know your time is valuable. We have the flood warning system, the satellite flood warning network that we have, and we partner with all the municipalities that enjoy the benefit of having that system in place. And then the number one partner is the USGS, United States Geological Survey. So that's a program that we budget for. In addition, we also support the regional hazardous materials team that Pennington County avails itself of, and the water rescue team as well. So those are all included under emergency responses. The hazmat, the water rescue, has not gone up for 2 years, and we've kept it steady this time as well. We've not increased that budget for several years, and we're okay with that. In meeting with them and talking with them, we're good there. USGS provides us the numbers for the MetWarn system. That goes up a little bit. That goes up incrementally every year. The next one I have is the Local Emergency Planning Committee. This is, it's easy to say it's grant funded, but that's kind of a misnomer. The monies are granted to the local emergency planning committees through the State Emergency Response Commission, of which I'm a gubernatorial appointment on that board. I'm one of the State Emergency Response Commissioners. But those monies are fees that are collected from companies in South Dakota that make, transport, or use hazardous materials. So if you're in a company that uses, makes, or transports hazardous materials, part of being in that business is you pay a fee to the government, who then trickles that back down to the local emergency planning committees. So that money is granted through the state, but it's not tax dollars. They're fees collected from the hazardous materials industry to support hazardous materials planning and public awareness. But none of that money comes out of the general fund or a specific tax that's levied. Those are basically hazmat user fees that support that budget. The pandemic flu is old, a hodgepodge of things. Community readiness initiative is probably one of the 2006 era contributions to that. That will be done this year. We will be done with that pot of money. We are looking at point of dispension exercise to be done with that pot of money. So that budget will not pertain to 2017. We'll close that out and that'll be done. Mm-hmm. Homeland Security equipment. This is the budget that is 100% grant funded from the Homeland Security. It's called the State Homeland Security Grant Program. So obviously DHS and FEMA provide a grant opportunity to eligible organizations under the auspices of Homeland Security. We never know who's going to actually be awarded what. So I put a spending authority in this budget so that we don't have to continually come before you with unanticipated revenue and supplement requests. So this is basically a spending authority that's completely dependent on what organizations are successful in their Homeland Security grant application. So when they're successful in their Homeland Security grant application, it runs through this budget. The money is granted through DHS and then paid out all through this budget for tracking.
Do those grants all come through you or like the sheriff's office or someone else?
So the State Homeland Security Grant Program is morphed and changed over the years. My office used to mm-hmm. actually manage all of the money for Pennington County, and we were given granted a significant amount of money. Those amounts have greatly decreased. Now they're awarded on a regional scale. So the grant money is distributed to Region 4, which is 9 counties in western South Dakota and the Oglala Sioux Tribe. So Brian Mueller, there's a law enforcement representative and then the emergency manager from each of those counties. So two people from each of those counties sit on a committee that are involved in how we divvy up those funds. So those funds are granted to the region, and then representatives from each of those counties sits around and figures out how those grants are going to be awarded.
So are you part of that?
Yep. Brian Mueller and myself are who manage that for Pennington County. And honestly, when it comes down to what Pennington County is going to do, it's actually run through the users board, the emergency management users board. So there's commission input, there's city council input, National Guard, Pennington County Fire, all those people make those decisions. I'm not a voting member of that board. I'm not a voting member of that process. All I do is make the arguments that board instructs me to make. So I'm kind of the torchbearer. I'm not actually involved in making those decisions.
So Dustin, what's the total amount in this budget this year that you are asking from us for the increase?
For the Homeland Security?
No, for your budgets in total. Or the only one that you asked for is your...
I'd have to go through and...
You have a lot of budgets here, son.
I do have a lot of budgets.
Some are, I already know, are grants and stuff because I'm on your board, but...
Yep.
I guess I'm looking for
the... And then, like I said, the city
total
stuff is due months ago, so it's a very disjointed process.
And then,
there is about a $1,800 increase in the MetWarn budget that we really don't have any control over.
Okay.
LEPC, I'm anticipating actually $5,000 less this year. Like I said, the water rescue team, hazmat team are staying even.
Just the increases, Dust.
Yeah, I'm looking at it as I go.
You're okay. That's why I said there's a lot of budgets in there.
Homeland Security is a decrease.
Good.
That's a decrease. So in my main budget, the first one I talked about, 226-0285, My total amount that I'm asking, well, the total budget, not the total amount that I'm asking, my total budget is $368,700. Last year was $366,470, so it's $2,000-ish more this year than it was last year.
Pay about $3,800 for everything you're asking for this year.
Well, actually, that's not fair because he's also got a lot of decreases. Yeah. If you take that $5,000 decrease, then he's not asking as much overall for his department.
And I can briefly go back to that couple thousand dollar. I tried to keep it, I tried to ask for nothing more. And the two things that impacted that were, we've got a phenomenal room over there that gets used a lot, and the AV package over there is great, and it supports how that room gets used. When we first had AVI come in and do these rooms for us, the current IT director was not a fan of support contracts.
Right.
And so we were advised to just pay as we go for repairs, and that we didn't need a support contract. Didn't agree with it then, and we now have an IT director that understands the value of those contracts. So I have a pretty significant support contract that I'll have in place with AVI to keep that room functioning the way we need it to function.
Right.
We have some things right now that aren't functioning the way they need to function, but the cost to do those individually versus a support contract, I'm just waiting till next year when I have my support contract in place. The other thing that goes into that is the uninterruptible power supply room. So we have a room back there that in IT that is nothing but a room full of batteries that supplies the server room for IT and the emergency operations center as well. I'd never dealt with a room before like the communications center. The ESCC has always had that. That was a new thing for IT and emergency management, and again, didn't understand the costs involved with the maintenance and service contract for that, and was informed by Lori. Lori and I had a couple of conversations, and she said, hey, this is a significant expense. You're one of the users. We need to partner up on this. So again,
And Dustin, I understand that what I'm saying is it's $3,800, but I guess my question is, if there was a major storm, how much does Pennington County put into that major storm? Or is there anything that we might need to supplement or do a what if? Because I know in Rapid City with snow removal and a couple of things, they do the what if, or they used to when I was there anyway.
So there is a...
Does that make sense instead of...
There is a disaster fund that's right. Not managed by my office. That lives under the auditor's office. I don't think Pennington County has levied in that for a significant number of years. Basically, there is no parachute. There's no slush fund. There's no pot of money that says if we have a large disaster, this is where we tap it. So as exampled in the October 2013 blizzard, it's absorbed by the highway budget, by reserves, by whatever funding sources are there. And if it's large enough that it qualifies for either state or federal assistance, then that money comes back in. But each department that's encumbered by those costs deals with those costs and comes before the commission to try to figure out funding solutions.
You made me remember, Nancy, didn't we take some money out of the emergency disaster?
We did. We did. And we
it was up a few hundred thousand.
Yeah. And then, you know, Heine and Tom have budgeted in the past for that sort of thing because they always have something, it seems. This last winter was kind of weird. We didn't really have a lot of storms or major storms where they would have needed to use that sort of thing. But they have historically done it by department that's affected.
And highway usually takes the brunt of that.
It does.
Do we have any kind of total from those storms that we had that how they affected, the amount they affected Pennington County by chance?
Oh, gosh.
2013, the October blizzard, Pennington County, if I remember right, we were right around $500,000, right around $500,000.
Yeah, that's what I remember.
And then the last years, was it last year or year before that we had those major storms?
So it was whatever the culvert replacement was on Palmer Gulch, and George might know, Commissioner Farabee might know what those costs were to replace was the
almost $300,000.
Palmer Gulch, I think that was a $250,000-$300,000 project. And then we lost the bridge on Antelope Creek, completely washed that bridge away on Antelope Creek.
That's another $250,000.
Just from those spring floodings there, we're back up to about $500,000.
And we're also, with Tom saying he has less in his budget, and we have storms, and he has to take money out of his budgets, we need to consider that. And
definitely,
that's why I'm saying that. Where does the money come from? And I knew it did, but it's good to put on notice. And
Highway takes the brunt of disaster-related costs in Pennington County.
Right. And that needs to be a factor in maybe when we're doing his budget as well, because we took $2 million, and now if anything major happens, we're going to supplement him anyway.
We don't have the money.
That's the nature of disasters. They happen, and you don't really have a choice. You can't vote not to deal with the disaster. It comes, it happens. You have to.
Right.
You have to deal with it.
We have mechanisms for that.
Yep.
We can put it in additional property tax to pay for it. There's other stuff than to just start building up budgets not higher and higher and higher. And
no, I don't think you ought to. I think there always should be somewhat of a what if in there of contingency on departments that have to suck up costs in case of that if they are already.
Just to
below.
You're right. And just to ease your mind, historically, our county has always done that. This is my 10th year. Every single year, I'm aware of how, and it just kind of gets so you know that, because you're not an old dog like me yet. So, but they do. This county is very, very good about planning for that sort of thing. And but we don't have, I remember when we took action where we did not every year fund that disaster pot, because what was happening is that the different departments were funding for disaster planning, and then we had this pot, and that was not fair to the taxpayer. So we pulled that back, and we haven't been putting money in it, but we use it. It's there. We can use it when that happens. And when that's gone, that'll be gone. But in the interim, we have operated that our individual departments plan for it.
But we also didn't have a wheel tax that took $2 million out of a highway department and then didn't put back in there. So that's what I'm saying. The what if in there is what I'm talking about.
And we aren't increasing property tax, so, yep, he's got a lot to figure out.
And that's going to make it so he might have to levy, or we might have to levy later on taxes. I'd rather do the what if than come back and tax.
That's why I really, I know we made the motion to not consider that tax increase on Tuesday, but until, I don't believe in those tax increases, but we have a situation where we needed to hear from him, and that's why I wanted to hear from him before we made a decision.
Right.
But the decision's
made. We went through all that before.
Huh?
We went through all that.
How much does
but I have a question.
Yes,
that
sir.
Is current. When we went through this last year, too, your group insurance, and I know this is minor stuff, your group insurance went down. Now, you got the same amount of employees with the same amount of insurance as you did last year, correct?
Yes.
So how does the other one go up $50,000 in group insurance?
I think we have to ask that.
I mean, I think Commissioner Farabee's, I think he did it last year, and I thought maybe we did. We got to do something with that group insurance. Everybody's doing different stuff, I guess. Maybe we need to put one big pot and say, here it is. I don't know, but this doesn't make any sense to me at all.
So
it's not a lot of money. It's a little $50,000 here, $50,000 there, and pretty soon you're talking big money.
Well, how much
one of the things that may impact that and cause some of the variation is when we have turnover and we have new employees, we may have one new employee that takes the whole ball of wax. We may have another new employee who takes nothing,
yeah,
has insurance otherwise. And in that respect, I don't think you're ever going to pin it down to a precise number. And I don't know what our turnover rate is, but
it sounded like it was high in that department.
Well, I can, Lindell, that's exactly why mine went down, is last year's budget, I was bringing on a new employee, Mark Enright, and I didn't know what insurance he was going to take, so for last year's budget, I budgeted that he was going to take everything available to him. Now that he's here and working for me, and I have a dialogue with him, I know what he's taking, and it's not the whole package, so I'm able to budget less. But those numbers are, they're not my numbers, they're set by the health, I mean, I don't have any flexibility in what I do with that. That's mandated to me from the Healthcare Trust Board and the commission.
With the county policy the way it is, it will never be totally predictable.
No. Yeah, when it comes to the insurances, the workers' comp, I take those numbers straight from the auditor. Again, those numbers are, I don't have anything to do with those numbers besides calculating them for the employees that I have. And just to echo Commissioner Buskard's statement on those disaster funding, like I said, you've got that reserve fund, you're able to levy, you've chosen not to, and should a disaster occur, you have the ability to levy that fund for a specific disaster. So, like I said, the mechanisms are there to recoup those costs. Any other questions for me?
We're just full of questions today.
Tom?
Come on, you're supposed to know Tom's stuff, and then you help him, and then he helps you.
Thanks, Dustin.
All right, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Dustin.
Thank you.
Donna.
You're next, Donna. Good morning.
Good morning. Donna Meyer, Pennington County Register of Deeds. All right, there was no changes in my fees by state statute this year, so I'm stay at the same level there. I am requesting for a new employee. It's really become overwhelming. The public is just not communicating with their neighbors. They just want to come in and search it out in our office, and it takes up a lot of our time, and also working with the attorneys. The attorneys have finally figured out that we are only going to give them the last deed. That's it. But it's time-consuming sometimes with some of the legals that they get into to find it. But the biggest thing has been the public. They're coming in unbelievably, and there's more phone calls calling, asking these questions, then we have to tell them, you have to come in and search it. So, and that's not something that's normal for the everyday person to do. So you're spending time showing them, we do show them, if it's going to be a long search, we do show them how to pull the documents, but you're always having to assist them. And also, so it's pushing our workload back, so we're not getting it done within about 3 days. We are right now sitting at 8 days. So, it's something that I figure I better get it licked now. So I am asking for another employee, and my revenue that I pull in does cover that with a little bit of surplus.
Donna, when's the last time you asked for an FTE?
I had a FTE in the years of 2003 and 2004 for a short time to help us through the large document count that we had at that time. And after they dropped back down to a normal level, or a little higher than normal, but a normal level that we could maintain, I didn't hire back again when they left. So as far as I know, the last time there was another employee added to this office was probably before I even came on board. Because it used to be, we have 7 employees now, and I remember having at least 8 or 9 people in that office when I used to come down as an employee for the title company.
And have we computerized or changed any of the computerized systems to make it?
Oh, yes.
Okay, what do we do different now?
We have, instead of putting a label on every page of the document, we just put it on the front page. We have started, we scan every document instead of putting them in, copying them on a copy machine. We have, I did purchase in 2010 a computer system that we do our indexing, all of our indexing in. Now, that does, it does save us in one step, instead of having to retype all the documents again to put them in the PT 55 report, which is a state report. And so the computer does generate that for us. So I've done pretty much everything I can without, what we need now is we need a human being. We're to the point where we need a human being because we need the help with the public back in the real estate room.
So you made it as efficient as possible with computers in your system until the point where, you know, you need, you do need that other FTE.
Yes. And it isn't like our population has stagnated. It has grown. So there is just a lot more questions because now it's required when they put up a fence, they used to just go out there and put a good old fence in their backyard. Well, now they can't do that anymore. They need to have certain information that's coming to us and they have to get it from us.
And what did you say your total amount of your FTE was?
My total right now is 7.
No, your amount that you're asking.
Oh,
what would it cost
FTE?
For that new FTE?
The total would be $50,427. It would be just for the salary.
Insurance.
And OSHA.
Okay.
Okay, and retirement.
That person's just a backroom person or switch back and forth between the files and the...
They'll be predominantly with the real estate room.
Okay.
Yeah. It just depends. It depends if one of my front people decide that they want to move back there, then I've got another cross-trained person. And I can start them up there in front in another position up there. It's just depending upon which person would have an interest back there. And if I think they can handle it.
But most of your people can go both front and back.
There are a couple of them that can.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Yes.
So the total amount of fees that you bring in, Donna, are?
1 million.
Is that increased because of some of the computerized systems to make it more efficient, or has it just been about the
same? In 2012, our fee went to $30.
Okay.
And there is $5 that is taken out, so technically in our general budget, our general fund, it's $25 per document.
Okay.
So that has kept me at this $1 million revenue, because I was pulling that in up to about 2009, and then it started dropping off. But when we changed that, and we changed that to start the M&P Fund, Modernization and Preservation Fund, so that all of us could keep up on the computer, computerizing, and also preserving our documents, because a lot of the counties do not put their documents on film.
And there's a lot of counties in South Dakota that don't do half of what we do.
Correct.
Is there anything in the other counties and other states that you've looked at that you would like to do that would make that department more efficient, or you've done?
I'm keeping tabs on it already.
Thank you. The company
I have for my doing my technically my recordings in, they are very progressive and they keep me up on what is coming out there.
Nice, Donna.
There is a software that they said that it's an octave. What it does is it reads the documents, and it can start the process of putting the documents into the system, which can save us time also, but it's not there yet. There is a lot of work that I need to be doing to get us ready for that, which I don't have time because I'm doing the work back in the back trying to pull them forward and plus trying to do my work. So quite frankly, I'm getting tired of late nights and weekends. And right now my Crohn's is back, and so that's making life even more miserable.
Well, you made your department more efficient,
which is
good,
yeah.
And then increase the fees where they should be in order to run that department.
And right now, South Dakota is being patted on the back because with the new laws that, to make things supposedly supposed to protect the...
More secure.
Protect the buyer. And so the closing statements have to be even tighter as to what amounts of money were issued out and what's on that statement. And because South Dakota has a flat rate, we have been used as an example by PREA, which is Property Records Industry Association, and NACO as one of the states to look at that we have with our laws and the way we did it, that we were one of the best ones.
And I'm not always into increasing fees, but I also like efficiency in our departments where we can actually get things done for people and actually not have to increase taxpayer dollars on people using the system or using that department for what they need sometimes. So,
and I am moving along because in my modernization and preservation fund, I have a large amount in there of $60,000, which I'm going to be using to redact our documents. I was going to do that a number of years ago and realized that I didn't have enough documents into my land recording software that was available to the public. So instead I took the money and I had all of the documents from 1974 to 1998 that were on FISH, and we had active data digitized them. So that has made more information available. Now I can do, through Modernization and Preservation Fund, redact those documents, taking off Social Security numbers. I can then make it through an internet process for people to do searches that way. These larger companies that are calling us, we can cut down on some of them.
That's funny, because I was going to ask you that, and I remember we asked you that before, why you couldn't, and because it would release too much secured information. So you actually went in and found a way to do it so it could be efficient and still be secure. So that's pretty awesome, Donna.
So yeah, I'm not the new one on the block, but I'm trying to make it work. And so I am now ready at the point, and I've got enough money buried to get me by 2017. I'll have enough money to have that process done. And then I can implement that. And there'll be a little bit more in revenue coming in, because they will have to pay a fee to be looking at the documents.
And I'm sorry, Ms. Nancy.
Well, I'm glad that that preservation fund is working, because we were a little concerned when that law went through that Pennington County would not get a fair share of that, because there were so many needs in the smaller counties. So at least we're getting some buildup. Mm-hmm. In it so that we can do what we need to do. Yes. As well.
Yes.
And Donna, and were the piece that got that done, so.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Yep, she was the driving force in order to make the counties, not just Pennington County, efficient, so, and help the other counties.
Well, it was a bunch of us worked together, so.
I have a question.
Yes.
How many of your fees are set at the county level, or are they all set at the state level?
They're all set at state level.
And that's legislatively done?
Yes. My recording fees, the copy fees, the fees for the marriage records out there, the marriage, birth, and death records, that is all set at the state level.
So essentially, you are delivering to the citizens of this county a service, and that reflects your management, and whatever they pay as taxpayers is dictated by the legislature.
Correct. Yes.
With
the vital records, the birth, marriage, and that one kind of sits in my craw, but sorry, I'm jumping ahead of myself. Sorry. It is a 15.
So you're getting on your soapbox.
Yes. And there's not much I can do about it because it's set by the state. There is a $15 fee. The only thing that the county gets to keep of that is $5. So every time I have to work up the report to present to the treasurer as to how much money to send to the state, I'm sitting there going, okay, come on, Donna. They created the system, so it's great. This is a great state because you can come. If you were born in South Dakota, you can go to any registrar of deeds and purchase your birth certificate or your marriage record. You don't have to drive to that county or send by mail. And there's other things too. And then also, anyway, it just gives me, it kind of burns me because I'm thinking,
I do the work.
85% of the vital records that are issued are done by the county. So it does save the state because they do have that small vital records office at the NPIR, that is the state office, that they can, the public can go to also. But I figured $5, that's all. So, but anyway, that's, I have just remember that we are county employees and we are servants to the public. We're providing a service.
Back to the other fees, that those are hard numbers. Are there up to numbers?
No, they are hard numbers.
There's no discretion.
No.
And the reason I'm asking that, I'm sure the others have got the same comments I have, is why so much?
But, the $30.
For whatever document it might be, those are set numbers. You can't, don't have any flexibility.
Correct.
So that when we are asked, we can tell folks that we have no control over that.
Correct.
And if they want them changes,
they need,
there's 105 people they got to talk to.
Correct.
And not to us.
Right. Correct. And
thank you.
The amount we selected, what we did is we looked at, because mortgages are sometimes about that thick. And so with the equipment that we have to maintain our records, because these are permanent, like you can't ever get rid of them. They have to be always available to the public. So from, I've got documents back there from 1877 to present day. I have to make them available to the public because you have to go back to that, those old, old documents and look at them to prove up that you've got clear title to the property. Yeah. Or sometimes find an easement that somebody had talked about and they've been using for, you know, the last 50 years. Well, now somebody wants proof that where did it come from? So we got to go back throughout to all those documents. But we kind of averaged out as to how much these documents cost, the old fee, so that the county would not be losing money when we went to the flat fee of $30. Did I lose you?
Well, that's set, but the numbers are set by the state.
Correct.
And that's the, you know, you would know that stuff, we wouldn't, and some constituent asks or somebody asks, why so much or whatever, and but we can legitimately say, if you want it changed, go talk to your legislator.
Right.
Thank you.
Okay, any other questions for Donna? Thank you.
Okay. You're welcome.
Thanks, Donna.
Have a good day. We get a little break.
Lori.
I tried calling Lori. I haven't gotten an answer yet. Asked her to come down. But
call 911.
Call EMC. Answered the highway stuff.
Of items you guys are going to have to talk about and set priorities. And if you guys want to take some time to talk amongst yourselves, you can do that now while we wait. For your wishes.
What do you want to tell us?
Well, should we just take the top item on your list, and or is that what you're wanting us to do?
Well, most of them are going to have to be actual decisions on an agenda when you take official action. But, you know, I'm just going through. I mean, you've got comp plan. You've got to decide. I'm going to list out all of the new employee requests because there's a lot of them this year.
We have a list for you.
You guys are going to have to decide, you know, where your priorities lie, if you're going to grant them all, if you're going to grant none, if you're going to grant some. We've got the litigation liability that's sitting out there. There might be another mechanism for that, though. Capital case costs, we've got the highway money sitting out there. So we have a lot of things in the mix this year.
It'd be nice to have that. I did put some comments like each department, their increase in their budget on a separate sheet instead of each one in a separate.
You want one total
like, these guys want this, and then in there, what FTE they have, and that increase, how much that's going to cost, or is that in with the total that they already, you know, did they already put it in their budget with that FTE in it, or two FTEs?
They do.
This year, we were very specific in telling them if they wanted an FTE, they had to present that budget separately. And that's what,
so these are separate, and then, so we, that would be nice for the list. They want three, they have an increase of $358. The two FTEs would increase at $74,000, whatever.
So I will make that list. I will get it to you guys so you can see by department what the total cost is per FTE, and then you guys can vote on those at a commission meeting.
But in addition to that, it, yes, we would have the cost, but we also need to understand, as in some of them that have testified, that they're going to be funded by outside sources.
Correct. And that would be
so that is important for us to understand. So like if in ESCC, they want to get two new employees, but one will be funded by the state. So, you know, we kind of need to keep that in mind as we evaluate this.
And I can put that as a separate column and put whether it's grant funded, revenue funded, conditional.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely, I'll do that too.
I thought he said one funded by the state, one funded by public safety, and they needed one.
No.
No, two. One would be funded by county, one would be funded by the state. For dispatch, you're talking, correct?
So the state was the public safety one?
Correct.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Correct.
Okay.
Okay.
And health insurance, we will double check those numbers, absolutely. The
yeah,
one
I was
did seem way
that.
Too high to me. But again, we'll double check those numbers on how they got there.
Unless they're just worried they're going to lose all those people again for turnover.
But that's what we did last year, and was took that ability to add in full family for everybody you think you might turn over. That's what we took away last year.
Yeah.
Yep.
We can't take away their ability to put it in their own budget, but Julie, we only allowed them to add so many family mm-hmm. because yes, that's where a lot of extra
that
money
wiggle
was
room.
In. The wiggle room was in. So we took that away last year, but we need to double check.
Yeah.
And some of those high turnover departments, you have to put in family. Yeah, otherwise, we're going to be back in front of you guys for supplements.
And
so.
I agree with Lindell. That's the way that some of those departments have to run because of that turnover.
Yeah. But that one seemed too high to me, too. So we'll double check those numbers for you.
If IT, I'm reading this right, $733,000 for 12 people?
In insurance?
IT, if I'm.
No, that's got to be total salaries.
Oh, okay. I got their own line. These lines are too small. I'm going
to
get a marker on this thing.
I totally agree with that.
That's why I like the bigger.
I thought it was unusual.
Different
you have a whole page
year.
Here. If it could have just been spread out, we could have had an easier thing to read.
Do you guys care to see 14 on there?
14.
2014 actual on there? Because that is one column that I could get rid of. And hide the rest of them, because I'm going to have to reprint these after provisional, so I will absolutely do my best to make them as big as I can.
Yeah,
I don't mind seeing
I
that.
I don't need to see 14.
Okay, because that'll save me space.
I don't know about the rest of them.
I guess what I like is the bottom line, and then once it's all broke down, it's a lot easier, and that's what you're doing anyway for us, Holly. What total department, what is their increase? What is their FTE? I mean, because those are the bottom lines for
that's
us.
That's on your budget summary tab in the front of your book. That's what all of those are by bottom line.
Yeah. Okay.
But the FTEs you don't have broken out, so I will do that.
So we'll just add that to that page?
Yep, absolutely. We'll do that
I was looking at this last night. You just practically have to have glaring right here for me to see. I can't.
Okay, my apologies. We won't
better damn
them
and have
bigger.
A marker.
Yeah,
you go across those lines.
And I didn't have a magnifying glass. I need to go get one.
There's so much information that we didn't want to leave anything out.
And I appreciate that, really.
Yeah.
I do.
These glasses make me see this very good, so I have no problems.
So maybe I need to go get new glasses.
Come here.
I better go do that.
Dark, you two girls with our guys, whatever, people.
We could get an office pair and share.
We'll get a number two. I'm
meant 1.5, we'll give you the 2 1.
Anything else you guys need or want to see differently, just let me know, I'd be more than happy to do it for you.
I think you read the things on my paper that I was writing, so that's funny, we're, and the Nancy addition, which was good.
She's here.
Oh, should we wait for George?
It's okay, I know, we're ahead. My turn, huh?
Should we wait for George?
Yeah, we'll wait until Commissioner Farabee returns.
You know, just as a part of the conversation here, maybe the way we handle some of the shortfall is to levy for emergency and put it in an emergency pot. And then that releases some of what he has to put in his budget historically in highway for emergency disaster. Maybe that would give, I mean, it's like maneuvering. I don't like doing that, but.
I don't usually, even in my own budget, I try to do something where there's a what if for utility things like water heaters and
sure
things that might happen on, except the, with the five properties. I mean, so it seems pretty, unless, like you said, you got it covered, but depends it, how much snowstorm or snowfall you have or how much, you know.
Yeah, we haven't really had an issue in the 10 years for the way they do it, but what we have now is a very different situation where we don't have money.
Right.
And you know, yesterday we mentioned, well, you know, maybe we won't put snow removal, you know, snow removal won't be, you mentioned that. And the concern for all of this is that the county is now in a position where we're not going to be able to do things like immediate snow removal. And what we do is we put people's lives at risk by doing that.
And that's why I say the we're known for the county, even when it was in the city, for being more efficient.
Yes,
and
always.
How they do business, taking care of those roads. And then I wasn't trying to discount the role. What I was saying is,
sure.
And a couple of people, we have talked about that with the highway department. We're doing one driveway for one person, mm-hmm. and we're fixing a culvert in there that costs us 200 and some thousand. To me, that's not prioritizing.
And here's another thing that I was thinking about. Remember on Tuesday, we had the gentleman here who wanted us to fix something, but actually when you looked at it, there were three road districts all involved with that. And I may be wrong, but my understanding is that the road district collects the money to fix those things. And if they have not been doing that, we should not be riding to the rescue.
And the bottom line, Nancy, is the rule is a 40-unit rule, and same with the city.
Mm-hmm.
So when you move into something without a second access, I mean, that's your choice at that point. There should be a safety factor in there, but again, you're making that choice to, and a lot of people I've seen, even in your county since I've been here, they don't want that second access. They don't want that traffic through their road. So, I'm going to say that's why they live on that road, is because they didn't want that second.
You're exactly right. And about 8 years ago, we started through this process, and we did some, and really the volunteer fire departments were the ones that were most concerned, because they couldn't get in and out with an ambulance or a fire truck. And so we did start changing that, but so much in the hills is predating 6, 7, 8 years ago.
Well, we're adding to that issue by letting them do smaller roads and doing 10-foot roads and 12-foot roads. So your emergency, so if you're doing 30 people in a instead of 40 in that area, and that road, we're agreeing with a 10-foot or 12-foot road in that area,
but,
like the one we did further out, you couldn't turn around
But we do, we are, we never used to, but we are requiring currently turnarounds so that those emergency vehicles can go down the more narrow road and turn around and come back. They have those, if you look at the maps, you'll see this circle where they can turn around. The older ones, though, I mean, like I said, we've just started that the last several years. Prior to that, it didn't happen. So sometimes that's, the age of the road is a real factor in how that goes.
I think we'll hold this for lunch, our lunch discussion.
Sorry, Lori.
And take advantage of Laura's presence.
And Holly did bring us lunch, so thank you, Holly, for making us lunch.
Good morning, Commission. This is Lori with Pennington County IT Director. I'm here to talk about the budget today. Our budget for the IT department is pretty simple. The one thing I do want to discuss is our FTEs. Like Julie stated on her form that she turned in, we have 12 paid FTEs at this point in time. We actually have 13 approved FTEs. I'm going to take advantage of that at the end of this year, like about September, October, and bring on another programmer. We have a programmer that's going to be retiring next year. So I have included that third person in my budget for 2017 because our programmer isn't going to retire till towards the end of the year. So it hasn't been, it'll be almost a full year for both positions. So, okay. Other than that, I budgeted for that. I have reduced our payroll by $90,000, which is transfers that come from other departments that are they're funded by outside entities, and so we do an expense to these other departments based on hours and services that we provide to these departments so that we can get our fair share from the outside entities. So,
Case.
Anything else? If you have any questions.
I have one.
Okay.
Services and fees. Pretty good increase there.
What I have done is I pulled back a lot of the, there was some services and fees that were being paid by outside departments, and we feel that they should be in the IT department, and so I pulled those back in and brought them more into line to what they should be. I've documented all of them if you'd like to see what they are. They're various licenses, license agreements.
No, I guess I don't really care about that. I just want to make sure the other departments are then subtracting that.
Yep, I worked with all the other departments on what I was going to pull back into our budget. Actually, I've kind of started paying for them already this year because I had an excess in our budget for this year. So they are aware of it.
I'm sure they are. But what I'm saying, it's very easy to say, well, we had $100,000 last year. That's $100,000 this year. But they just transferred $20,000 over to you. So, I want to make sure that in their budgets, they've taken it out. Well, we assume they did.
But I assume they did, too. I communicated with them. Some of the examples would be like their Barracuda updates. We have one for the web that I pulled back into our department.
And once again, it's not all that much money, I guess, but.
Yeah, it is a little higher than it was previously.
That explains it.
And that's why. So
any other questions? None of our people would do anything like that, would they?
Not intentionally.
Okay, that's the key word.
Very good, Lori.
Any other questions?
Any other questions or comments?
Doing a great job.
The salary decreases what again?
Excuse me, what?
The salaries decrease?
Part of it is because we do a transfer from the other departments, and it's a lot higher than what it has been in the past. We're doing a transfer of $90,000. I believe last year maybe it was budgeted for $45,000. We brought those costs more in a line so that we can get the appropriate funding from outside entities. So the departments will be transferring funds over to us, and I
pay for your services.
Mm-hmm, I take that off of our payroll item line. So yeah. So that's part of the reason why it decreased. There was also, it decreased a little bit because of wages too.
Well, those are the kind of things that taxpayers should like to see. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Lori.
Thank you.
Good job.
Laura came. One of the things that impresses me when we talk about taxes and taxpayers, the attitude toward the county is conditioned, in my opinion, by the fact that the tax notices and all the taxes are collected, sent out from here and collected here. And yet, somewhere around 21, 22 cents of every dollar that's paid goes to the county.
It's 18.
And the public doesn't think about that. They just are mad at the county because of whatever happens to their taxes. And so I have personally, just whenever the occasion presents itself, suggested to people that they figure out the county's share of their tax bill and lay alongside that tax bill their smartphone bill and their cable TV bill and see which is the greater. Just for sake of interest.
That's very interesting.
Yeah, we collect, and I agree, we collect a lot of the taxes so people think it's the county's issue.
Yeah.
But even on property taxes, 60, almost 70% goes to the
schools.
Yet we are doing the equalization hearings, and there's not one school person up here. So we are taking the burden off a lot of those areas like state and county and schools and cities by taking the brunt of it by collecting it here. If they had to collect it in the school area, district area, I think it'd be different, or the state to show where those, and here's the bottom line. A lot of that's by state law, whether it's collecting taxes or assessments,
no,
our Department of Revenue. And once you get in here, you still are surprised by where most of those taxes are going.
There are at least 35 statutorily required functions that the county must carry out.
Yep.
There are around 45 statutorily authorized functions that the county can fit their demographics or whatever and pick and choose. And in that respect, then, if you want to be mad at government, we have over 150 road districts in the county.
Mm-hmm.
We have 12 townships. We have city governments. We have school districts. We have the county. So if you want to be mad at government, pick one.
And the difference between county and that I learned in city is city may and county shall.
Yeah.
It's set that's, in county and city may. And I guess what I tell people is whether you're running or you're in here, look at what you're talking about and what you're saying about taxpayer dollars, because you'd be surprised if you listen to Lindell or anybody else or just look up the laws that you're blaming the wrong people. And it isn't a blame, it's if those services, here's the bottom line, if those services aren't needed, let's eliminate them and decrease the budget. That's my bottom line.
But in terms of the present situation, instead of always being on the defensive, I would encourage some proactive thoughts on how to educate the public on the position county government occupies. And you'll never stop the chirpers who are always against everything, but it may create a situation where state-mandated procedures delivered in the most effective and efficient way you can at the county level is the bottom line, and stewardship of that system rests right here in this county, at this dais.
Now, along those lines, when we're working on the budget this year, and this is just my opinion, but I'm pretty sure it's correct, we've just about exhausted what we're going to get out of the state legislature for quite
yes,
a while.
Yes, we have.
We've gotten road license plate fees increased. Now we got some liquor fees. We're just about done to go. Yeah. We can't keep going back to the well because they're not going to understand it until the legislature changes another two or three times and more people get in there. And it looks to me like the legislature this time is probably going to be a little more conservative than it has been. So I think we better live with what we got because that's what we're going to have for a while.
And along with that, you know, attending those county meetings last year for the special summer study, one of the things that happened at those is that all that we've said here, we knew locally what we were required to do. We knew our limits. We knew that we did not have funding. Here's some things that came out of that. The legislators that were on that committee finally got that they continue to hand down mandated things that we need to do at the county level with no funding.
Yep.
And I think that that was an important discovery for them in that committee. And probably it's not going to be maintained, but I think it's important for us to keep that message out there. The other thing that became very apparent to them is that, and it goes all the way back to Governor Jenkel, you know, when we started doing the property relief, the governmental entity that is affected by the property relief is the county. It's not the schools, and it is not the cities, it is not the townships. The county is the one that suffers the brunt of that decrease in property tax. You know, and so they've set up a situation in Pierre where they don't even think about what it does to a county. They don't get it. And it's very, very important to realize that if you tell us you got to do this program and you got to pay for it, that they recognize that that's going to make a very difficult situation, especially for smaller counties. Here in Pennington County, we have not taken increases in taxes over and over and over just because we could. What we did, and this a whole group of departments do, is they go out and they collaborate and they find ways to make it less expensive to offer a good program, and you hear that. And I think that it is unfortunate that people think we just blow this money when we are known across the state. And actually, when I testified this summer, I got ridiculed because they didn't think it was right that we would get up and advocate for some kind of increase in fee or something because we don't increase our taxes to the max every year that we can. And of course, my response is, well, we believe we need to be very efficient, and we have been, but there are times when we just can't be, we're at the end of the kind of money that we have available.
And that's apparent to me just from going to the state and being on the county representative for SB 73. They're mandating programs. They're saying how they're not putting more people in jail, just like SB 70. But their diversion programs
are
our issue. But then I see most of the money going to state programs. So, yeah, I kind of...
Yeah, it's a frustration for us.
Not a nice way.
I have pointed out to lots of committees that I've been in front of, and they just look at me with this deer in the headlights look.
Yeah.
That there is a state law that says they cannot mandate the county to do something without sending the money along to do it.
Yeah, well, they did give us at a $9 million.
And they don't, it bounces off of them like, well, and of course it doesn't matter, because if they ever recognize it, they'll just repeal that law, so.
Well, $9 million and $250,000 come to us, but most of their programs, the diversion programs that are coming back to us because of their people not going into jail are our responsibility.
And they brag about how much money they're saving at the prison, yeah. They're all here.
Well,
and the mental health issues are the same thing. You know, they've done that to us where we're being forced, and as Kevin mentioned, he's got a mental health person that he had to hire because there's no place for him to send these folks that need help. And so it's put back on the county then.
Well, there's places for you to send them, but unfortunately, they're all full. And mental health is a huge issue.
Well, and
for
here,
cost and people having it. I just kept hearing at Collective Impact, there's lines of people in behavior management and other mental health systems in Rapid City that you can't get in.
But here's why you can't. Because a couple of years ago, the state legislature changed, I think it's about 4 years ago, they changed how they ran our state mental health facility in Yankton. And they supposedly gave money for new employees and to have it open, but several of those wings of that hospital have been closed for a long time.
They did some more diversion programs.
Yeah.
they claimed they didn't have enough doctors.
And employees, and they couldn't keep it. So then we couldn't send anybody there. There was no place for them.
They just passed it off to somebody.
Mark, you're just going to have a lot of fun up here.
Well, you got a woman in the legislature, challenge. So then now you can help us through what you know on how this really works. Because I think, and I'll still say, before you move to the next step, state or even federal, you should have to go through the lines of being either city, county, or something, so you know how much you're affecting other people by what you're not doing or what you are doing, because it make a difference.
When the state legislature is considering something that's going to affect the county, we do send county commissioners to, right?
Yeah. And
what Ron's saying is that it just bounces right off.
Yeah,
because it saves their budgets, but puts it on ours, so most of them aren't going to just do that.
And one of the things, Mark, that has been most frustrating to me in dealing with PEER is that they will be considering something and the legislature never comes back to a county and asks, how does this affect you? They will just go ahead and do it, and then you'll find out that they've made this decision and you're going, wait a minute, why didn't you come talk to me? I could have explained how this could work. It doesn't matter what your relationship is.
Without notifying you.
Oh, sometimes things happen like that and you're done. Yeah, you can't get there quick enough. It's 3 hours away.
Anybody have any thoughts on the governor's decision?
What?
To delay Medicaid expansion?
I don't know that he's made that decision.
That's what I heard this morning on radio.
Maybe. He's not going to call a special session.
Okay.
That's delaying Medicaid expansion. It was probably a done deal if he'd have called a session, but he decided he didn't have enough votes. So
that was the headlines in the paper.
It'll just cost him more in the long run to try to catch up like he did before. He was already $51 million behind, and now he wants to try to catch up again. I don't agree with all that Medicaid stuff in one sense, but the other... Republicans need to reform that Medicaid program to the point where it actually works.
It does, but the other part in the paper today was that Social Security is going to run out sooner than we think, and Medicare is going to run out sooner than that. Mm-hmm. So, yes, does it need reform? Absolutely.
That's the bottom line.
So then
you can whine about it, but you've got to reform it. And if you don't reform it, you're going to cost your state a lot more money in the end. But I don't want to look like a Democrat in this case, so
we
don't want to do that.
But we also have to be careful of the federal government. They promised when we took out some bonds that they were going to pay half of the interest or a third of the interest. Well, they reneged on that immediately. And now that's costing us money. So you can't believe everything that the federal government says.
I agree.
But you got to do something to make that solution so it works for the future so you don't lose that many millions, too.
And you're right, but I am kind of curious to see what will happen with the at the federal level that we don't have any control over.
No.
Yeah, and maybe the state has the same issues as we do with the feds, I'm going to guess.
Sure.
But back to Medicaid, community health pushed it really hard, and I don't know, wouldn't pretend to know all the intricacies of their financing, but community health, the board really wanted Medicaid expansion.
All medical, yeah. And Rapid City Regional, all of them wanted it pretty bad.
Okay, ready for lunch.
Yep. We've had enough.